How do I write a good research paper? How do I improve my academic writing skills? What can I do to increase my chances in a job interview? How do I curate the best resume for my dream job?
Ever since the beginning of Christ deemed to be university, need has been felt to bridge the gap between the seekers of knowledge and the source. For that, Christ deemed to be university, through the Center of Academic and Professional Support, CAPS, brings you India's first professional online writing lab, providing students with opportunities for self-learning at their own pace. We aim to offer expert consultation and peer interaction opportunities to all Christites at free of cost. Our one-on-one interactive sessions, online tests, and digital certificates adds on to a better learning experience for the users. At Christ Online Writing Lab, we provide assistance at all times to our diverse audience and help them to enrich their professional and academic skills. Some of the courses that we offer are appearing for a job interview, resume writing, art of note-taking, Introduction to Professional Communication, Research Writing, and Academic Writing. In contemporary times, accessibility is the key to education. It is the only way that allows us to tap into everyone's potential. With the advent of digital medium, education is now available to everyone who wants to learn. This is our contribution to the history of Indian digital education. Christ Online Writing Lab.
Hello, welcome back to another session on the art of photography. In this session, I'm going to speak about decision making. Now, when it comes to decision making, it's more about knowing the cameras so that you can get a better idea and then you can decide which one to go for. So before that, we'll have to go through the features. Now, let's look at the features of mobile cam. Any mobile cam you take will have fully auto function. Since you have this function, you don't have to worry about any of the settings. The camera will take care of everything based on the situation. But then you won't have any control over any of the settings. If you want to change the brightness or anything like that, it's slightly difficult. Of course, you can do certain things, but in fully auto, you won't be able to do that. Now, that is when you'll have to think about the manual function. So in manual mode, there are a few settings that is available in few of the mobile phones. These settings are not same in all the mobiles. So in some mobiles, you might find these functions. In some mobiles, you may not find. So if you have any of these functions, you can make use of it. So the first one is the shutter speed. By now, you know what is the shutter speed. So if you have the settings for the shutter speed, you can go for it. Next is the aperture. So the same as like any of the DSLRs. So if you have the settings, you can change it. If not, you have no other option. Then the ISO. So in some mobile cameras, you'll have the ISO. So if it is there in your camera, then it is well and good. Then you have the multiple cameras in latest mobiles. So each camera has its own specific functions. So if you have that one, then it is well and good. These days you have extra lenses available. So if you are looking for any such lenses, you can go for it. Now, what you have to keep in mind is these are all phone specific. You cannot get all these functions in all the cameras. The lenses maybe you will be able to use in any of the cameras, but rest of the settings that you have, it may not be available in all the cameras. Fine. And then the biggest problem that you are going to face in mobile phones is the limitations in terms of the range. For example, if you take the aperture, mobile phones won't have different aperture settings. Mostly the cameras will have single aperture, so you won't be able to change the aperture. But there are few mobiles which has multiple cameras. Each camera will have a different aperture setting. In that case, then you have some up to a certain extent, you can change the aperture, but that will be limited to either 2 or 3 maximum as of now. So if you look at ISO, ISO mostly you won't have much of an issue, but then still ISO, the range that you're going to get is going to be very minimal compared to any of the other DSLRs. So that is something which you have to keep in mind. So limitations is one big problem that you're going to face in that. Now, when it comes to the choices that you are going to make, whether you have to go for a mobile phone or you have to decide whether you have to think about a DSLR or not, that is the main thing. If you are happy with the mobile phones, it's fine. But then once you know about the DSLRs, you know the features that is available, then obviously you will have to think about going for a DSLR. Well, now from limitations, let's go on to choices that you're going to make, the choice factor. So when you have to think about the choice that you are going to make, it's more about whether to go for a mobile or a DSLR. Now, if you have a mobile that has all the specifications, still you will have to think about a DSLR if you're looking for something better. Let's look at the advantages of DSLRs. The first one is the dedicated camera. When you're using a mobile phone, obviously, you know, it is not meant for photography alone. You're making it, making use of it to making calls or maybe even to message or whatever it is. But when you're having a DSLR, it's not meant for anything else, but only to take either photos or videos. So you'll be sticking to that. So if you get a phone call during taking photographs, then obviously you don't have any issues. The next one is the range of settings. In the previous slide, you would have seen that mobile phones has limitations. I spoke about the range problem. Here, if you look at a DSLR, you have a wide range. Of course, it depends on the model that you're going to take. So the first one, let's see, it's shutter speed. So when you're using a manual shutter speed, you have a range that can go even up to 8,000 of a second. So that is very fast. Then again, like, I'm not saying that all the DSLRs will support that. Then again, like, you'll have to think about which, if in case if you want so high shutter speed, you'll have to go for specific models. Fine. So the shutter speed can range from, like, there are some cameras wherein the once you click it, it'll be open. Until you release a button, it's not going to close. So you have a wide range. It can go even up to minutes. Okay. So that is a slow shutter speed. Even up to 8,000, you can get in certain cameras. So the range that you're going to get in a DSLR is going to be very high, which is not possible in a mobile phone. Fine. So next one is the ISO. You can just check in your mobile the range that you're having in case if you have an ISO settings. If you look at the ISO settings, it is going to be very less in mobile. But if you go for a DSLR, it can go from around 80 or 64. That is the lowest ISO. It can go up to lakhs. Fine. Now I'll show you a photograph. Here what you are seeing is a photograph taken in high ISO. Quality is so bad, but then I don't know if you can think about the ISO that it was taken at. This was taken at 2,4,800 ISO. Fine. This is a very high ISO. Normally, like, when you're using any camera, I would suggest not to mobiles. I'm not sure because I haven't tried it. But if it's a DSLR also, if it's a normal DSLR, the range that you can think about is around 800 to 1600. Above that, you're going to get grainy image. But if you look at this one, it's not in thousands, it's in lakhs. So at 2 lakhs, above 2 lakhs, this is a one I've got. So you can see the difference. So this range, you'll never get in a mobile phone. Now, next, if you look at it, one advantage is, like, when you're using DSLR, you can actually connect it to your mobile phone. Now, why this feature is required is at times when you're shooting at very low shutter speed. There was a time when I was taking a photograph of the eclipse, lunar eclipse. So at night when it is so dark, you need to get that shot. So your shutter speed is going to be very low. So when I was trying that, the moment I clicked, that shake itself was making the image blurred. So that is when I had to think about something else. So when you're using a DSLR, normally you'll get a trigger. There'll be a wired trigger with which you can click and you can take the photograph. But then these days it is still easier because you can connect the DSLR to your mobile through a Wi-Fi. So through the mobile you can click, you are not going to touch the DSLR. So that will actually avoid the shake in low shutter speed conditions. So that is a really good feature that you have. Now let's look at another things that is about the camera decision that you're going to take. You need to know a little more about the camera parts, fine? The camera is consisting of two parts mostly in DSLRs. If it's a phone, you know, it's just one single part, but when you are looking at a DSLR, it's actually two different parts. One is a body alone, another one is a lens. So if you look at this, what you get is the camera body. This is without the lens. This has a shutter inside. So this shutter, you know already how it works. Now, this is actually covered with a mirror. This mirror is actually used to get the image on your viewfinder. So when you look through the viewfinder, what you're seeing is what you're going to get as your final output. That is why you use a mirror to reflect that and get into your viewfinder. So what you're seeing is actually the same image that you're going to get. But these days you have mirrorless cameras, so they have avoided this mirror. So the space it takes to flip the mirror is avoided. That is why these days the mirrorless cameras are more sleek. Next one is a sensor. So if you look here, the light that goes in, like in the film camera I showed you, the light goes through the lens and it enters. There will be a mirror which will actually block this. When the mirror opens, when you are actually clicking the shutter, the mirror opens and then the shutter opens. So the light goes through the shutter and it falls on the sensor. That's all the image is captured. If it's a film, it will go to the film. But here it's a sensor. DSLRs is digital, so it is falling on the sensor. That's how the image is captured. When it comes to sensor, there are two things. One is the quality of the sensor. It depends on the mechanism or the technology which they're using. There are different types of technologies. So that actually makes a lot of difference in terms of quality. The next thing that comes into picture is the size of the sensor. That also plays a huge role, fine? So the basic one, if you can think about, it's mostly the mobile phones, you have one size of sensor. But then beyond that, if you're looking at DSLRs, it starts with micro four thirds. So micro four thirds sensor size is comparatively smaller. That is the smallest maybe you can think about in DSLRs. Then you have the crop sensor or the APS-C. This crop sensor or the APS-C sensors are the most common that you'll see around. It's quite affordable. So the size is actually comparatively bigger than micro four thirds. And this will actually give you a little more space. So when the sensor size is becoming bigger, you'll get more area to cover, fine? Now, next one is the full frame. So this is slightly expensive compared to a crop sensor, but this will have an advantage because of the sensor size, you will notice that you'll have a better ISO setting. That means low light conditions, it'll work better compared to either the crop sensor or the micro four thirds. Then the next thing is the area it's going to cover. So you'll get more area. That is again an advantage. So this will actually again result in a better depth of field. I mean, a narrow depth of field. So certain times if you need such a narrow depth of field, this will come handy, fine. The next one is a medium format. This is not commonly used, but normally for advertisements and billboards, to get pictures for billboards, they used to make use of this. It's pretty large compared to a full frame. And again, like you have still larger one, that is a full format. These are all not commonly used and it's pretty expensive. So if you look at the sensor sizes, so this is how it looks. If you think about an iPhone, maybe comparatively, if you look at this, you can see the size of the iPhone sensor. Now I'm going to show the micro four third sensor. So this micro four third sensor, you can notice the difference, the size difference. So this brings in a better quality. There are times where you require a micro four third, especially when you're taking macro photography. That is maybe it will come handy because you'll get a better close shot of the subject. Fine, that is for macro photography. Now, crop sensor size is bigger than a micro four thirds, so obviously the quality will be better, the low light sensitivity is better. Fine, but when it comes to full frame, this is again larger than a crop sensor, so this is going to be still better. Once you start using your full frame, you'll find the difference, then you'll be finding it difficult to go for a crop sensor camera. But keep in mind, full frame sensor cameras are costly. You have the medium format, you can see the difference in the size of it, then you have the full frame format. So this is how it looks. So there's a huge difference between all these sensor sizes. So this will actually create a better quality as far as the sensor size goes. The larger the sensor size, the better the quality. Now you have learned about the sensor, let's go next to the lenses. Now you have a body, the body takes care of the capturing and all, but then the entire thing is coming through a lens. Fine, so lens is a very crucial part of a camera. So let's go through a different types of lenses. Normally when you purchase a camera, you'll get a kit lens along with that. So this kit lens will suffice. Up to certain extent you can manage with this. So if you really feel that it is enough, then you don't have to worry about anything else. You can still take good photos with the kit lens. The kit lens will have a range. Fine, normally if it's a crop sensor, the lens range, it's about the zoom range, that is going to be around 18 to 55 normally, or even 18 to 105 or something like that. So this is the range that you're going to get. So if you have that one, up to certain extent your needs are taken care of. You need not look for another one. Only if you feel that you need certain specific kind of photographs, then you have to think about different kind of lenses. Otherwise you can manage with the kit lens. Now kit lens, you'll have one issue, the aperture is not going to be constant. That is one thing you have to keep in mind. The next one is a tele or the zoom lens. Now what is a tele lens or a zoom lens? If you're using a mobile phone, if you want to get closer shot of the object, what you have to do is you have to move the camera towards the subject, otherwise there'll be a lot of things around. To avoid that, you have to move the camera towards it. So if you are taking a person, and if the person is standing far away, the person will be very small, there'll be a lot of background, but because the person is small, maybe you didn't want that. So the only option is you have to go towards the person. So when you go towards the person, you can feel the person in the frame. If it's a mid shot, you can keep the mid shot in the frame, but then at times you might even zoom in using a digital one, that is you will pinch and zoom using a mobile phone, but there the problem is you are going to lose the quality, so that is not advisable. So using a mobile, normally what you do is to keep the quality, you are going to move. Suppose if you want more area, you'll be going backwards. This can be avoided if you have a tele lens. So once you have a tele lens, you just have to turn it, you can get it closer or far away. So this will actually help you take photos without positioning yourself. From where you are, you can take. For example, if you are trying to take the photograph of a lion, if you are having a mobile phone and if you want a close shot of the lion, you'll have to go near the lion, then you may not be anymore. So the only option is you need to have a zoom lens. So with the zoom, wherever you are safe. From there, you can zoom in and take the photograph. You can take the close shot of a lion, right? The next one is a wide lens. These wide lens are something with which you can cover a huge area. So if it's a big building, if you want to cover, you can cover that one. Or if you are in a room, and if you don't have a wide lens, what is going to happen is, if the room is small, and if you are taking a group of people, it may not fit in your frame. You would have experienced this often when you are taking shots in a mobile phone. So you'll try to go back and back and back, but if the room size is too small to the extreme end, you still may not be able to cover the entire group. So that is where a wide lens comes handy. So if you have a wide lens, with that itself you can cover the entire area. Fine. Now there's something called fisheye. When the wide is too much, then it will end up with a fisheye lens. So you will have more extreme wides where you have fisheye effect. These photographs, when you take, it will be slightly bulged because of the lens mechanism. The image will be slightly bulged out. At times, it looks good. Usually, these fisheye lenses are used to cover huge gatherings to show how huge the gathering is, or maybe a building which is too huge. Like if you want to show it that way, then maybe you can use fisheye lens. But otherwise, if you are trying to take portraits with a fisheye lens, it is going to be horrible. The person will look like a ball, so that is not advisable unless you want to make a funny picture. The next one is a macro lens. Now, what's a macro lens? In one of the sessions, I was speaking about the macro function. If you have a macro lens, you can go very close to the subject and take the photograph. So if you don't have a macro, what will happen is the more closer you get, the image will not be focused. So to get the subject in focus, you need to have a macro function if it is very close. So there are lenses with which you can take even from a centimeter away from the subject. So these are mainly used for taking photographs of tiny insects and very minute objects. So there is something called prime lens. Prime lenses are like lenses which is normally like even known as fast lens or fixed lens, mainly because it will have a better aperture, I mean a high aperture. So when you have a high aperture, it will help you in two ways. One is you can get a low light shot. At the same time, you will get a very narrow depth of field. So if that is what you're looking for, then you can go for it. One thing that you have to keep in mind is there are tele lenses, there are cheaper ones. If you purchase that one, you'll have issues because the focal length, when you change the focal length, the aperture is going to vary. So if you are completely wide, when you are trying to zoom in, the aperture is going to reduce. So your picture will become dark. Again, you'll have to make the adjustments. But if you have a fixed lens, you don't have to worry about it because once you set the aperture, it's not going to vary. Even if you zoom in, it is not going to vary. 50mm is a prime lens. It's really good for taking portrait photographs. Fine. So this will have a fixed high aperture. 50mm is something which is really cheap, and then you'll get amazing photos with a 50mm. This is something which you can think about along with a kit lens. After that, maybe you can think about a tele lens. Again, it depends on your requirement. Fine. Well, now let us look at the camera settings. So before you start using the camera, you'll have to make certain settings so that it will continue for almost all the pictures. Maybe later if you want, you can change it. So you'll have to go to the menu, and one thing that you have to do is to set the file format. Usually you have two file formats. One is a JPEG and then the RAW. You have options like you can either shoot all the pictures in just JPEG, or you can shoot all the images only in RAW, or you can shoot in both the formats. If you're shooting in JPEG, this is a compressed one. So when you try to work on it, you will be losing the quality. But if you're shooting in RAW format, then it will have entire details stored in it. So you are not going to lose the quality. You can do a lot of editing in that, but still you can retain the quality. So if you want to, you know, make it more brighter or darker or anything like that, you're not going to lose the quality of your image. So that is a really good thing if you're working with RAW. But that is not required always, because the file size is going to be very large. Usually if you are shooting a file in JPEG, the file size, if it is around 10 MB, the RAW image is going to be around 25 MB and above. So the file size is so huge. For you shooting itself, your memory card is going to get filled up soon. Later for storage also, it will be very difficult. If you are going to do editing, you are going to spend a lot of time on editing. So only if you are using it for professional use, and if it is really required, maybe you have to think about RAW format. Otherwise, it's better you shoot in JPEG itself. Now, the next one is image size. So image size also, you can actually change it. And again, it depends. Like if you are shooting only for maybe only for sharing it in Instagram or any social media or in websites or anything like that, you don't have to shoot in large size. So in that case, you can reduce the size of your image. So storage also will become more. You'll have, you can shoot more number of images. At the same time, even editing also will become easier. You don't have to sit and resize it always. So in that case, you can go for a smaller size. But if you're very particular about the quality, then and the size of the image, you can keep it large or in between the medium. The next is the quality. Quality also you have to decide, like if you are looking for that great quality, or if it is for websites and all, I don't think you require high quality images, so you can reduce the quality. So the next one I'll go through will be the controls. So what are the controls you have in DSLRs? Like any mobile phone, you have the auto settings in your DSLR. So this auto mode, if you're using, you don't have to worry about any of the settings. The camera will take care of it. But the biggest issue is you don't have any control. So what you're looking for, you may not get often. So that is when you have to think about the manual settings. So in manual, you can set each and everything. You can control your camera based on your requirement. Otherwise, what will happen is in auto, as I said, the camera is taking control of the settings that will decide what to do. But here you are deciding. If you are really keen on or particular about certain things, then obviously you'll have to look for manual mode. You cannot go for auto mode. Then you have different modes available. You have different scene modes. So that is something, again, quite amateur. You don't have to go get into the those kind of modes. Then you have the programmed mode. It's something like you are programming it. You make the settings based on that situation. Then you have the priority modes. You have different priority modes. You have the aperture priority mode. You have the shadow priority mode. Here, what you're doing is actually you are giving priority to these settings like aperture. Suppose you are giving priority to the aperture. You are making sure that aperture is not changed. You are setting the aperture. Same way with shutter. So if it is in shutter priority, you'll be setting the shutter. So that is again almost a semi-auto thing. Then now let's go into the manual mode. Mainly in manual mode, you are controlling the camera based on your requirement. So every setting, you are very sure you want that particular one, so you're going for it. I was speaking about the exposure triangle, so by now you should be aware of it. You have the shutter speed, aperture and the ISO. All these changes will affect the brightness of the image. When you increase the ISO, the image will become brighter. Or if you reduce ISO, the image will become darker. If you increase the shutter speed, it will become darker. If you reduce the shutter speed, it will become brighter. If you change the aperture also, for high aperture, it will be bright. For low aperture, it's going to be dark. Now, all these are affecting the brightness. So when you change the settings, all you have to keep in mind is you have to balance it. Because if you touch any of these, the other has to be used to compensate. Otherwise, what will happen is you won't get the correct exposure. So by adjusting these, you have to get the correct exposure. So let's look at the shutter speed. I'm just going through once again. The shutter speed actually will, as I said, like it will change the brightness of the image. But most importantly, it is about motion. So the main reason why you're using a shutter speed is to get the motion how you want it to be. For high shutter speed, the motion will be frozen. So any moving objects will be still. So that's how you take it. At the same time, if you are reducing the shutter speed, that will result in a motion blur. So any object that is moving will be seen as a moving. That is a blurred image. It will be a motion blur. So that is the main reason why you use a shutter speed. And this will again affect the brightness. That is something you have to keep in mind. The next one is the aperture. So the aperture, you know, when you change it, and the reason why you need to change the aperture is mainly because not of the light, but to get the depth of field, whether it has to be narrow or wide. So if you are using the aperture, you will have control over the depth of field. So if you are using a high aperture, you'll have a narrow depth of field. If you are using a low aperture, you'll have a wide or broad depth of field. Next one is the ISO. ISO is the last thing I would say is to be done, because ISO will affect your quality. Fine. So if you are keeping it low, it's fine, but if you increase it, it'll be a problem. Now, ISO is more about gain of the picture. So if you are taking high ISO, it'll become brighter. If you are reducing the ISO, it's going to be dark. And the most important thing that you have to keep in mind is the problem in quality. So first you work on the shutter speed and the aperture in case if you feel the brightness is not based on your requirement, and if it has reached that amount, then obviously next thing, that means if it has reached the maximum or minimum, only then you have to think about this. So, or if you feel that that is a particular setting that you want, then if you want to make it brighter or darker, you have to make use of the ISO. So if you notice this image, it might look okay for most of you, but the quality is actually very bad. Since the size is small here, you may not be able to make out the difference, but if you make it in actual size or a little bigger size, now you can see how horrible this picture is looking. So for high ISO, this is what is going to happen. But again, the ISO range will be based on the model that you are using. So if it is certain models that have high ISO, you can go for high ISO. If not, you have to make sure that that ISO setting is kept minimal. So now let's get into the decision making. That is a choice factor. Now, what choice will you make? The choice, again, like now, if you are thinking about the DSLRs, already you have two options. Now, knowing so much, you'll have a better idea whether you need to stick on to the mobile phone or you need to get into DSLR. So if you are moving on to DSLR, there are certain things that you have to keep in mind. The most important thing in decision making, I would say, is a budget. So if you have the budget, then you go for it, because the pricing is in a higher level compared to a mobile. Again, mobile phone, as you know, you can use it for everything. But if you need a dedicated camera, then obviously you'll have to look for DSLR. And for actual photography, if you are really enthusiastic about it, I would say not to work on mobile phones, because with DSLRs you can get amazing stuff. You can do a lot of things that mobile phones won't let you do. So once you think about the budget, and if the budget is fine, then the next thing comes is the field of interest, because you have various products available in the market, and the price might range from around 20,000, 25,000 up to lakhs. So you have to decide which one to go for. So here, not just the budget. Of course, if you have a great budget, like if you have lakhs of rupees to spend, then you need not worry about all those things. You can go for the higher end ones. But at the same time, either if you have a lack of budget or you don't want to spend, even if you have a lot of money, but you have to spend based on your requirement, then the field of interest is very important. So based on this, you have to decide on which camera body you have to purchase. So when it comes to the camera body, you know, there are different sensor sizes. So that is very important. So which sensor size you're going to look for, whether it is micro four thirds, whether it is APS-C full frame or medium format or the full format, you have to decide based on your budget as well as your requirement. So if you're working for big industry like advertisements, where they are going to put up all the photographs on billboards, huge billboards and all, then maybe you'll have to think about large formats and beyond that. But still, even a full frame format will work for that. You don't have to worry much about it, because these days most of the full frame cameras will have enough capacity to do that, large images and high megapixels. But if you are very keen, or if you want to impress your clients, then you can go for higher end cameras. Otherwise, a full frame camera will be sufficient enough. But if you're using for a normal purpose, like at home, or like even only for websites and things like that, then any APS-C body or a crop sensor body will be more than enough, because you will get amazing outputs with that. But if you want to impress the clients, then obviously maybe you'll have to think about at least full frame. So that is if you are getting into business level. Otherwise, I would say that a crop sensor will be more than enough. Then again, why micro four thirds? Micro four thirds are like actually good for macro photography. So if you are doing something based on that, then micro four thirds will be more than enough. The next important thing is the ISO sensitivity. Again, based on your budget and the field of interest. Now, there are a lot of models. Even if you look at a full frame, if you compare with a APS-C camera, what you're going to get is a better low light sensitivity. But then again, in full frame itself, you have wide ranges. Some full frame cameras that will give higher ISO sensitivity, but there are cameras which will comparatively give lesser than that. So you have to decide on what is the ISO sensitivity that you're looking for. Because like if you're shooting more in the night times and things like that, then obviously you need to have a better ISO sensitivity. So in darker areas, you would require higher ISO sensitivity. This again depends on your thinking, because as I showed you the image with the high ISO, I have shot that in more than 2 lakh ISO. But still, if you feel that, I mean, for me, it is horrible. I normally don't go beyond 4000, but just for experimental purpose to show you, I have shot at 2 lakhs. But then I don't like such kind of photographs. That is why I always prefer to get high ISO settings cameras. But otherwise, even a normal crop sensor camera, you may not notice the difference if it's for a website or showing it showing to someone on a tab or a mobile or a laptop. I think a normal APS-C sensor would do. And one thing you have to keep in mind is that low noise that you get at higher ISO is what you have to think about. But then what is the range you are looking for? If you are looking for something around, like if you take a normal APS-C camera, I would say the ISO sensitivity you have to keep within 800, maybe up to 3000 or 3200 you can go. Again, depends on the platform at which you are going to put up that picture. So for a normal purpose, I think even up to 3200 you can go for, but I would suggest that you keep it within 800 if you are using a APS-C sensor. But at the same time, if you're using a full frame camera, normally I shoot up to around 1600 or even up to 4000. Beyond that also, for a normal person, they may not be able to make out much of a difference. Again, it depends on how you look at it. If you are very keen on quality, and if you have that thing of noticing minute changes, then obviously you'll have to think about something like that. Otherwise, APS-C sensor is more than enough. Next thing is the memory cards. When you're investing on memory cards, again, it depends on the camera, because the memory cards has a read-write speed. And for photography, most of the memory cards will support. Only if you're looking for videos, then you have to think about high memory speed. Otherwise, if you're using full frames with high capacity or large images and with high megapixels, then you need to think about high writing speeds, especially if you are working on fast shoots, like if you are continuously taking photographs, especially in terms of sports. So there is something called a burst mode where you can continuously shoot. In 1 second, you can go from six photographs to 10 to 15 photographs in 1 second. So if you're shooting that way, what will happen is, if your memory card is not fast enough, this will buffer. So buffering, it will take time, and you may not be able to take more than 10 to 15 shots. By the time you continuously shoot, it will get slowed down. And beyond that, you may not be able to even click. Until the entire pictures are written to the card, you may not be able to click another one. So in that situation, you need to have a very high memory speed. Usually, memory cards that if you're using a APS-C camera, maybe 45 Mbps would be enough. If you want, you can go for 80 Mbps. And you'll have to think about even one more thing, that your camera should support. If your camera is not going to write at that speed, there's no point in having high speed memory cards. You need not spend so much on high speed memory cards. So you'll have to even check what is the capacity, what is the writing speed that your camera has. If your camera can write only in a speed of 45 Mbps, there's no point in having a 150 Mbps memory card. So this is one thing that you have to keep in mind. So the speed of memory card is very crucial. You have to keep this also in mind when you're purchasing it. Now let me speak about the lens. So when you're speaking about the lens, you have to keep two things in mind. One is the budget and the field of interest. So budget, as I said earlier, if you have a large budget, you need not worry about anything. The field of interest is what you have to think about when you go for a lens. So there are the kit lenses. If your interest is not varied, and if it's a normal photography that you are taking, a kit lens will be more than enough. You can take most of the photographs with that one. So you'll have up to certain extent tele. If you go for a 18-55 for a normal APS-C sensor, it is fine. If you are having a full frame camera, maybe 24-105, maybe that is more than enough. That will almost cover everything. But if your area of interest is beyond that, that is when you have to think about this. If you want to get fixed aperture, when I say fixed aperture, it's not that the aperture will be always fixed. You can change it, but when you zoom in also, the aperture will remain the same. But if it is not a fixed one, in a tele lens, if you try to zoom in, the aperture is going to vary. And if you zoom in, the image is going to become darker because the aperture is going to narrow down. That is one thing you have to keep in mind. So prime lenses are slightly costlier, but a 50mm lens is not that costly. So that will be a good lens that you can start off with. You can invest on that. When it comes to tele lenses, a normal tele lens, maybe around 7300, will cost somewhere around 10,000 or 15,000. But if you want to go for a fixed aperture, then things are going to change. The same lens, maybe not even 300, 7200 will cost you around 2 lakhs. So that is one thing you have to keep in mind. So if you want to go for that kind of an output, then you can spend on it. And wide lens. Wide lens is something you require only if you are planning to shoot too much of sceneries and buildings and things like that. That is why I said field of interest is one thing that you have to keep in mind. Then again, coming to macro lenses also, you will get, it will cost anywhere between 35,000 to 1 lakh and above. So if you are really interested in taking the pictures of insects and small things like that, then only you need to spend on macro lenses. One most important thing that you have to keep in mind is a compatibility that you have to take care of. Fine. Then next thing is the external flashes. So if you are planning to purchase external flashes, you have to think about that. Here again, when it comes to flashes, you have to think about the compatibility. When you're thinking about the external flashes, one thing is the sync speed. So when you are shooting in high shutter speeds, what will happen is, if the sync speed is low, usually it will be around 200 range. So if you're shooting above 200, that is above 200th of a second shutter speed, then if the flash is not having a high speed, what will happen is your image will be cut off. Either half it will be black, or the entire image will be black, or a portion of the image will be totally black, because that is how shutter works. So the syncing has to happen in the same speed. So you'll have to think about high speed sync if you are planning to shoot that way. For normal purpose, you can use a normal flash which will have a shutter sync speed of up to around 200th of a second. So if you're shooting up to 200th of a second shutter speed, you need not worry. Any normal flash should work. But at the same time, even the camera should have a high speed. If not, there's no point in having a high sync speed flash. So that is one thing that you have to keep in mind. Then again, you can think about a soft boxes. That again, if it is about fashion photography or anything like that, then only you need to worry about soft boxes, or major events like where you can fix the soft boxes on the sides and you can fire the flash from your camera. For that, you would require a trigger. So only if you are using that way, and remotely if you want to control those flashes, then you need to work, you'll have to spend on a trigger. Next thing is about the compatibility. So I was stressing on the compatibility earlier. It's mainly because not everything is made for all the cameras. So you have to be very careful when you're purchasing these things, whether it is a lens or battery or the flashes or triggers. You have to make sure that it is compatible with your camera. One thing is the make, that is which company. So if the company is different, then obviously you may not be able to use those things. So if you have a lens that is of Nikon, you may not be able to use the same Nikon lens on any other cameras. Same thing is with Canon. So if you have a Canon lens, you will be able to use only on Canon. But these days there are some options wherein you can use an adapter, but it is not fully compatible. You should know which lens will support with that adapter. So that is something which you have to keep in mind. So whether it is Nikon, Canon, Sony or Fuji or whatever it is, compatibility is one thing that you have to make sure when you purchase any of these accessories. So if you have a battery, make sure that it supports. Even if it is the same make, it should support that model also. So if it is a Nikon 610 that you're using, you may not be able to use the same battery for a Nikon 3500 or something like that. So that particular model only you can use with that battery. Fine. Next is a sensor size. This is very important when you are working with the lenses. Of course, battery and flashes and all is not a problem, but when you are using a lens, your sensor size is very important, because if you have a lens that is supporting a micro four third, you won't be able to use it for a full frame. But at times, full frame lenses can be used, but again, there'll be a crop factor that you have to keep in mind. So compatibility with these sensor sizes, you have to be careful. So whenever you purchase a lens, you think about the make, that is which company it is, then you have to think about what is the sensor size. So next thing that I'm going to say is a $1 million question: which is the best camera? So far from my experience, I cannot say any camera to be the best, because every camera has its own advantage and disadvantage. Because companies, in the same company itself, they'll be having multiple models. All these will have different specifications. So the cost will vary, the settings will vary. So all these things will keep varying. So you have to decide before you purchase something, you have to decide what is your, based on your budget and the field of interest, you have to decide which camera you can go for. So if you want a better quality, then obviously you cannot stick on with the entry level cameras. That is when you have to go for higher end cameras. Then again, like, do you need such high ISOs? If you require, of course you have to spend so much on it. So same company will be making a lot of models, and every model won't have all these features. Many models will have certain features, many models will have certain other features. So all these none of the models will have all the features available. So you have to figure out from the specifications which is suited for you, and you'll have to go for that. Next is again another question about which is the best brand. There are different brands like Sony, Nikon, Canon or whatever. Again, from my experience, I have used Canon, I have used Nikon, I have used Sony. So far from my experience, I felt Nikon is far better. Again, when you compare, don't ever compare with a entry level camera of one make and the higher end camera of another make. Make sure that you compare with the same companies, different models. Fine. So from my experience, I have used the entry level cameras from Nikon, Canon and all. And at the same time, I've used full frame cameras of Nikon. Two full frames I have used, that is 610 and 750. Then I've used Sony A7 III. When I compare from my experience, I feel Sony A7 III is not great compared to the other, the Nikon cameras. So again, it depends on your way of looking at. And when I went for Nikon also, I had certain study made based on like the color combinations and things like that. So there I came to know that Nikon is better in that particular range. So that is why I went to Nikon. But the problem here is, as I said, like, everything has its own advantages and disadvantages. Nikon's color is great. Rest of the things, everything is, the images are sharp. A lot of advantages are there. But the biggest problem I faced was the focusing mechanism. Since I was taking a lot of videos, I had issues. But for photographs, it's fine, because you're not changing the focus continuously. But in videos, you are keeping continuously focusing. So if a person moves or an object moves, focus has to track it. So that is where I felt Nikon was lacking. So here I felt Canon was better, and even Sony was really good in terms of focusing mechanism. But when it comes to taking only photographs, I don't think it makes much of a difference. So any of the models is fine. Some people are very loyal to particular brands, but I don't see it that way. I look at whatever is better. So let it be any company, it doesn't make any difference for me. What I look at is if it is giving what I am looking for, am I satisfied or not? So right now I am using Sony, but I prefer to use a Nikon or a Canon when it comes to focusing mechanism. Of course, Sony is really great. I don't have any issues with that. But Canon would have been better. Even that has a better focusing mechanism like Sony. But for videos, I am saying I felt Nikon is not up to that mark as of now. Well, now that I have taken you through the different aspects of the camera, I'll just let you know what all softwares are available for editing. For editing from Adobe, you have the Photoshop and the Lightroom. So both works in different ways. Lightroom is useful for even organizing your images, whereas Photoshop is only for editing. So Lightroom has some editing features, which is really great because it is faster editing. And again, like you can either use any of these or even a combination of these. With Lightroom, you can work on all the raw images, fine. Then something that is becoming very popular right now is Affinity. It is very cheap compared to Photoshop. So maybe you can try out Affinity also. Then you have Darktable. Darktable is again a software which is really good. You can do the editing as well as you can even organize your pictures just like a Lightroom. So if you want, you can try out that one. If you're a beginner, I would suggest you go through Darktable because it is free and you can do an amazing job with that one. Once you are into photography, then next is about your marketing. Whether you are doing it for business or for fame or whatever it is, this is something that you have to keep in mind. So how do you do that one? So one thing is the very powerful one, that is the social media. So you can put your photographs in Facebook, Insta, or you can even create your blogs, or there is something called Pinterest on which you can upload your images and you'll get your views. So these are things that you can make use of to make your visibility, fine. Then you have portfolios. You can create your own portfolios or maybe you can create your own websites. When you are working on websites, if you are doing it in a professional way, then you have to think about security. You'll have to think about e-commerce possibilities. All those things you have to keep in mind. Or you can even create a normal website if it is not for that commercial purpose. Fine. Then again, when you are creating portfolio and portfolio, you can even create in Adobe. You have something called Adobe Portfolio, or even Behance. Behance works almost something like the Pinterest. So you can create your own pages wherein you can upload your pictures where you'll get visibility. What you have to keep in mind is again something which I said some time back. A creative person is at the crossroad where one leads to prosperity and the other leads to satisfaction. So at times, if you're lucky enough, both these will meet, or you have to make a hard choice whether you want to make money or you enjoy doing your things without gaining anything out of it. So it's up to you. With that, I would like to conclude today's session. Thank you.